He added that the continental system was nonetheless a great conception and was destined to win the voluntary consent of every people, for it was as much to the interest of individuals as it was to the interest of the continent as a whole. Prohibition against prohibitioners was common justice. Moreover, in his desire to establish on the continent industries that would make it independent of England, he had no choice of means. He had adopted the sole method which would really hit England's prosperity. It was a great undertaking, and only he could carry it out. If the present opportunity were allowed to pass, another would not come, for the enterprise had needed just that combination of circumstances which had, in fact, obtained in Europe during the last few years. He already had proof that he had not been mistaken and could cite in support of his plea the flourishing condition of industry, not only in the original territory of France, but also in Germany, and that too, even the wars were still going on. The emperor inferred from this that the continental system had built up the industries of France and Germany. It would therefore, he said, be a source of wealth, which would replace the foreign trade which we were at present missing. The benefit would be still more perceptible a little later. In less than 3 years, the Rhineland, Germany, the very countries which were the most hotly opposed to the prohibitions, would do justice to his foresight and his achievements. To have taught the French and the Germans that they could themselves earn the money which English industries had previously drawn out of the country was a great victory over the London government. This result alone would immortalize his reign through the internal prosperity it would bring to France and Germany. The emperor concluded from this that what I referred to as the colossus of the power of France was at that time a state of affairs wholly advantageous to Europe, since it was the only way to check the excessive pretensions of the English. England, he added, by the very fact that she weighed less heavily than he upon the chancelleries of Europe, weighed all the more heavily upon the people. For she seized for herself alone all the benefits of industrial development. As an island, she doubtless excited less jealousy and anxiety in the minds of governments that had no coastlines. Her maritime ascendancy seemed for this reason less burdensome to the governments of Europe than the ascendancy of France. Her situation precluded the danger of territorial disputes with them, but her exclusive commercial policy was nonetheless damaging to individual interests. This fact was not willingly recognized at the present time because the various governments found it convenient to go to London for subsidies when they wanted them. And it mattered little to them if the cash they received had come from the pockets of their own subjects, or rather had been earned at the expense of these subjects, whose industries would never be able to develop so long as the English monopoly continued. The emperor admitted that the annexation of Hamburg and Lübeck, towns whose independence was useful to commerce, must have alarmed the traders as well as the governments of Europe, because these changes were thought to indicate a policy which would be continued. But he justified these measures of expediency by the necessity of confronting England along the coast with our own rigid system of prohibition of imports. He added that, as he was in conflict with the actual trade of the towns, he must win over the sentiments of all thinking persons of the population. Constitutional government and our code of laws would bring about that change. Being unable to maintain an army of 25,000 men in the new departments, he had instituted governmental reforms to ensure us the confidence of the inhabitants. This step, he added further, which was wholly advantageous to the greatest number and in the true interest of the landowners, already counterbalanced the opposition of the maritime trading interests, which could not be expected to become friendly so long as they could not resume their activities and find outlets for their capital. The emperor's opinion was that far from giving way on some points, he ought to strengthen every measure that might force England to make an earlier peace. He thought it better to suffer severely all at once than to suffer over a long time, since the English tried every means to evade the prohibition of imports in order to support their industries and uphold their credit. It was his duty to do all he could to triumph over their cunning and force his enemy to yield. It is a battle of giants, he went on to say. The seaport merchants are caught between two champions. How could anyone help being jostled in the fight? But this fight to the death is in the interest even of the men who grumble. They will be the first to gather the fruits. The English have driven me, forced me to every step I have taken. If they had not broken the Treaty of Amiens, if they had not made peace after Austerlitz or after Tilsit, I would have stayed quietly at home. Fear for my commercial capital would have kept me in check. I should have undertaken nothing outside France, for it would not have been to my advantage. I should have grown rusty and easygoing. Nothing could be more delightful. I am no enemy to the pleasures of life. I am no Don Quixote with a craving for adventures. I am a reasonable being who does no more than he thinks will profit him. The only difference between me and other rulers is that difficulties can stop them, but I like to overcome difficulties whenever it is clear to me that the end in view is a great and noble one, worthy of myself and of the people over whom I rule. If the English had let me, he repeated, I would have lived in peace. It is in their own interests alone that they have carried on the fight and refused offers of peace, for if they had acted in the interests of Europe, they would have accepted them. Holding Malta in the Mediterranean and being in a position to protect other points necessary for the safety of their trade and the victualling of their fleet, what other claim could they advance? What further security could they want? But it is their monopoly they want to keep. They need an enormous volume of trade if their customs houses are to pay the interest on their public debt. If the English were acting in good faith, they would not so consistently have refused to negotiate. They are afraid they would have to explain themselves, and they dare not admit their designs. If we negotiated, they would have to put their cards on the table, and then the world would see which side has been acting in good faith. They say, and you are the first to say it, Palancourt, that I abuse my power. I admit it, but I do it for the good of the continent at large. Now England thoroughly abuses her strength, the power that comes from standing isolated among the tempests, and she does so for her own good alone. The good of that Europe, which seems to envelop her with goodwill, counts for nothing with the merchants of London. They would sacrifice every state in Europe, even the whole world, to further one of their speculations. If their debt were not so large, they might be more reasonable. It is the necessity of paying this, of maintaining their credit, that drives them on. Some day, they will certainly have to do something about that debt. Meanwhile, they sacrifice the world to it. The world will realize that in time. Men's eyes will be opened, but it will be too late. If I triumph over them, Europe will bless me. If I fall, the English will soon drop their mask. The world will see that they have thought of nothing but themselves, that they have sacrificed the peace of the continent to their momentary interests. The continent cannot, or rather should not, complain of measures that aim at closing it for the moment against English trade. The annexations that have provoked such an outcry are temporary measures. So he told me in confidence, they are designed to inconvenience the English, to wreck their trade, to break off their trade relations. They are pledges which I hold in exchange for our colonies, for those of the Dutch, or certain claims which the English must give up for the general good. Since peace could last, and could promise a future for everyone, only if it were general. If it was wrong, according to the emperor, to complain of all his efforts to achieve it, clear-sighted people and real politicians well knew what was his aim. The emperor asked me several times during the journey if I thought that Russia would make peace. He added that it would be wise of the Tsar Alexander to conclude it while he was enjoying some measure of success. I replied that I still doubted if he would negotiate so long as we were within his territory, and that the reverses we had suffered would not in the least incline him towards peace. So you think he is very proud?